Our adult discipleship, we're going to start off with page number 364. Page number 364 in your hymn book, and if you're able, we'll all stand and we'll sing. I think we still got a few folks coming in, but we want to go ahead and get started. Page number 364, Standing on the Promises of Christ My King. And we will start on that first verse. Welcome once again to the adult Sunday school class. Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail when the howling storms of doubt and fears assail. By the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord. Overcoming daily by the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Amen. Thank you for your singing. You may be seated. Let's have Brother Kevin and Brother Scott come at this time. We'll go ahead and take up an offering, and we're going to get right into our lesson this morning. And again, good to see you in the adult Sunday school class, and we praise the Lord for the opportunity and the day He has given us to be able to assemble together. Good to see Brother Scott this morning and Brother Kevin, and it's good to see you. Let's pray, and let's ask for the Lord's blessings on not only the Sunday school, but the teaching throughout the entire church, this class, and the preaching hour to come. Father, thank you for this day that you have blessed us with. We do ask and pray that you'll bless the offering as it's received, that you'll bless both the gift and the giver. We pray that your power and that your presence would bless the teaching of the word. And then with the church hour coming, the preaching there, we ask and pray that you would anoint that, the singing, the fellowship there, and everything that we do. We know that Jesus is coming back soon. We know that today could be that day. I pray that we're prepared and we're ready, and bless, guide, and direct. And we pray for this community. We pray for the southeastern Indiana, northern Kentucky, Ohio, greater Cincinnati area. We pray for all the men and women this morning who are not in church, don't know Christ as their Lord and Savior. We pray for them, God. We pray for their salvation. We pray for their development spiritually. And we just ask that you'll have your perfect will and way. Bless the day in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, men, thank you. All right, so this morning we are going to continue with this subject. This is our fourth lesson. And we're dealing with this topic of being offended or maybe offending somebody. And you know, on some of the lessons we elaborate more than others. Now, why that is, that we just leave that, we leave that sense to the Lord. But this is something that's extremely important, you know. It's something that we need to be understanding about. So today, we're going to start in two different places, but let's go to the book of Galatians chapter 4. We're going to start there in Galatians chapter 4, and then we're just going to look at a subject that's going to take us into this particular point in place of our teaching. And then we're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. In Galatians chapter number 4, if we look at verse number 12, in verse 11, Paul says, now this is to the church that was at Galata, which was dealing with and to some degree accepting teachings that were not New Testament biblical. Okay, Paul says in verse 11, I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. Now, with that coming from the great Paul the Apostle to the church that was at Galata, that can make them think very clearly about what Paul is saying. Well, what is it? What have we done? And of course, the letter addresses that. But what I want you to look is verse number 12 teaches us something. So there can be a thought of the church that was at Galata towards Paul when he says, I'm afraid of you. But now look at verse number 12 as Paul goes from himself back to the church. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye are. Now watch this. Ye have not injured me at all. Now that word injured me can deal with this thought. You've not offended me. But the voice teaches and the epistle teaches that they were offending in their teaching, because they were teaching certain principles and precepts of the Old Testament, kind of bringing that into New Testament teaching and preaching of salvation through grace. So Paul tells them, you've not injured me. Although he had offended them, and this word offense means somebody's injured you. So he's letting them know, you are an heir, you have not done right, you're not teaching right, but you've not injured me. But this is an offense to him. But he did not, watch, here's what I'm trying to show you. He did not allow the offense to what? Injure him. He did not allow that offense to injure him. Now, let me say this. We know that offenses are going to come. All right, let's go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Now, obviously, we know that the church at Corinth, there was a lot of offenses there. There was divisions in the church. There was schisms in the church. There was partiality in the church. There was a lack of biblical doctrine in the church. There was a lack of proper leadership in the church. And all of this is not so much to the world, but to the Lord, it's an offense. It's an offense. And I think sometimes we need to understand this in a sense of as a people of God. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Let's just look at verse number 5. But if any have caused grief, now when we are offended, we can be grieved because once again, we're injured. How's things going to church? I don't know. You know, we can be grieved there. But look what Paul says. But if any have caused grief, he hath not grieved me, but in part, that I may not overcharge you all. Now, if you study the first and second letter, again, Paul is saying is this, you have offended me. And obviously that's one of the occasions for the epistle, to straighten out the error. And there was a lot of error in this particular church. But Paul tells them that ye have not grieved me, but in part. So there was enough of the offense of that church to Paul the apostle to where it provoked them not to hurt him, watch, but to help them. And this is the great secret and sometimes the challenge of dealing with when you've been offended by somebody. Yeah, you've been offended, but are you going to allow that to injure you? Are you going to allow that to grieve you day in and day out? We want to talk a little bit about that, because how we react to being offended is key to your unity with that individual in 1 week from now or 1 year from now. Now, we don't plan out a year and ahead. I mean, I know we take note of today and the opportunity that God's given us. But I'm just saying how we react to being offended is key. Our actions towards being offended to keeping unity and progression with that individual in a relationship that would honor Jesus Christ. Let me say this. If offenses are not dealt with biblically, I'm not going to use the term correctly, because when they're handled biblically, they are handled correctly. But there are subjects and situations that are handled, somebody may say correctly, but the biblical grounds or the principles of the Word of God was not exercised. So if offenses are not dealt with biblically, here's what happens. They become more unmanageable and they compound to worseness. Guarantee you that. Now, as a pastor, I got to keep a great eye on this thing because part of my ministry is to develop unity in this church through preaching and teaching and leadership. And I have a responsibility to our other leaders as well to make sure there's no schism there that would interfere with what we're doing as a local New Testament church. And we all, once again, from time to time, we all have issues. That's not what we're saying. We're not going to, again, it's impossible, but that offense has come. We're going to deal with that. But we need to deal with them right, because if we don't, they become unmanageable. Unmanageable. And that leads into them just compounding greater and greater. And before you know it, this situation, you've heard somebody say, well, they've taken a molehill and made it into an anthill. And I guess that can vary on what kind of ants you're dealing with. In Africa, you know, an ant mound might be 7 foot tall. And here in the States, you know, molehill's that tall. So let's talk a little bit about today. We're going to move on in this particular subject of dealing with offenses. When you're offended, I think one of the very first things that you need to do, whether this is in your family life, as a mother, as a father, as a child, whether this is at your work life, whether this is something that takes place with a volunteer in the community or church, we need to be careful with the carnal nature. Number one, we need to be careful with the carnal nature. Now, what controls the carnal nature? Well, we know the Spirit of God convicts against that, but to control the carnal nature is the Scripture, the Holy Scripture. You know, we're told and encouraged and really mandated to live by faith and live by faith in the Word of God. But we need to be careful with our carnal nature. So when we're offended, the first thing that needs to come up in our mind is identification. You know, if somebody's coming down the driveway or somebody's knocking on your door, you say, who is it? And depending on where you're at, you may go upstairs and peek out the window. Because sometimes, you know, I get it. I mean, a while back, I was knocking somebody's door and, you know, it took a while and I heard somebody say, hold on. And I knocked on, hold on a second. So I waited and, oh, pastor, come on in. So after about a half an hour there, I said, well, hey, where's the wife? Oh, her hair's not right, and she's in the bedroom hiding. And, you know, she wanted to identify, who's at that door? Oh, man, I can't see him. And she shot into the bedroom. And, you know, and I get all that. I get all that. What I don't get is when somebody's real sick and they're really bad off at the hospital. I said, I'm going to come visit. I said, oh, pastor, I haven't had my hair done. I said, just put a pillow or something over you. I said, I'm going to come here and pray. I'm not worried about that, okay? And so we need to identify who's in control. Is it God? Let's just use the word Holy Spirit. Or is it me and my flesh? Okay? Now let's think about this. So we're talking about being careful with the nature that we possess when we are offended, because we have a dual nature as Christians. You have the new nature, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, and yet you have your old nature, which is depraved. And the old nature, the old man, is very much still alive. The only way that he's going to be suppressed and the only way that he's going to not get his will and way is by me and you walking in the very path that Christ lays out for us. And if we don't walk in that path, we know what path we walk on because it's the only one we're used to walking on. All right, now let's turn a little bit and let's go to the book of Proverbs chapter 24. Proverbs chapter number 24. Let's look at some wisdom that Solomon gives us concerning this particular subject. Proverbs chapter number 24. And I'd like for you to look at verse number 29. Okay. Proverbs chapter number 24. Please note verse 29. Say not, and by the way, typically this is in the heart. I guess it could be verbal too, but it's typically in the heart. Watch. Say not, I will do so to him as he hath done to me. I will render to the man according to his work. He says, no, you don't do that. When you're offended, you don't do that. I'm going to read it again. Say not, I will do so to him as he hath done to me. I will render to the man according to his work. Turn back, please. Proverbs chapter number 20. Here's another verse that connects with this. Chapter 20, verse number 22. Say thou not, or say not thou, excuse me. Say not thou, I will recompense evil. I'll get even with you, so to say. He says, no, don't do that. Now, note what he's saying here. Always there is the suggestion of the voice or the inner voice before there is the outward play. So whether this is in the heart or whether you just say it, he says, stop right there. Don't go no further. Period. Don't go no further. Now, this is the way Christians deal with problems. Now, let me tell you something. If we don't want to deal with them this way, hang on, because you're going to be dealing with your problem probably the rest of your life. Hang on. That's all I can tell you. Your problem will compound and it'll get more complex, as I said a moment ago, and it will not get better. And we want our problems to be answered because the Bible supplies such. Okay? Again, Proverbs chapter number 20. Verse number 22, say not thou, I will recompense evil, but wait on the Lord, and he shall save thee. Because sometimes we think that our actions, and I've been there, that our actions and our motivations will fix the situation. And God says no. And you know, a lot of times we may not even really understand what's fully going on, what's fully taking place. Let's go to the New Testament to 1 Peter chapter 3. Now let's just move to the New Testament. Obviously, this principle that Peter's sharing with us would work off of the Old Testament principles that are laid out throughout the Word of God. 1 Peter chapter 3. Starting in verse number 9, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrawise blessing. Whoa. Yeah, that takes some character, doesn't it? I'll be talking tonight on this particular subject. Character cannot be bought. It must be built. And this is the kind of carnal character that I think we're all to a degree familiar with. Not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrawise blessing. Knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. So when it comes to being offended, you've got to ask yourself, what's more important in your life? You putting your 2 cents worth in? Or, listen to what he says, for he that will love life and see good days. You ought to pick the latter. Your life ought to be more important to you and enjoying the days in which you live than rendering evil unto evil. Okay? Now, what are we talking about here? We're talking about being careful with the carnal nature, making sure that God's in control, and we're saying this. Number one, retaliation is a no-no. Retaliation is a no-no. It's something that we're not to be messing around with. Let me show you another thing that happens. Go over to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15. Luke, chapter number 15. And we're going to come towards the ending of the story about the son who went to his father, the younger of the son. At least there was two we know. There was an older and a younger, and this is the younger. And he went to his father, and he asked for all that belonged unto him according to his inheritance. And you know he left and spent all and wasted his substance with riotous living. We know that. And then he comes to himself. And he said, now, by the way, let me stop and say something. I can guarantee you This is not in my thoughts last night as I was noting this in my thoughts. I can guarantee you what this younger done offended his father. But his father did not allow it to injure him to the point to where he ever comes back, I'll let him know it then. Oh, no, you wanted to leave? Go on. Don't come back here. We ain't got no time for you. Go on. You made your bed. Go lay in it. Now, that's not in the story, but I can promise you as a father that the father was offended. I could tell you one that was offended. It's the older brother. When they had the Mary meeting and the fatted calf, the older brother said, I'm not even going in there. I'm not even going in there. And what am I saying? That's not how you deal with your offenses. You don't withdraw yourself. And a lot of people do that. They withdraw themselves. Look with me, please. At chapter 15, let's take note at verse number 25. We'll start there. Now we know the younger has come. The father is thankful. The younger son confesses his sin. The father is just, he says, bring forth the fatted calf and let's eat and be merry. My son, which was dead, is alive, and he was lost and is found, and they begin to be merry. And there is a point here. They begin to be merry as to say that prior to that, the offense took this away from their home. But again, the father did not allow this offense to motivate his love for his son away from him. I've seen that in ministry over the years. I have seen that. I can't justify anything like that, nor can I unjustify, because I don't wear them shoes sometimes. But I have talked to people, and you know, somebody's getting ready to pass away, and I said, well, have you contacted your family? My family have nothing to do with me. Well, maybe now is the time to contact them. We have. One time I remember reading an obituary about a gentleman in Texas, and it had the gentleman's name and his date of birth and then his children. And then it says, we're very thankful today that this scumbag is no longer on the earth. It's true. He was about as poor as a father can be. He left my mother at a young age, married two or three other women, never took care of his children. He was an alcoholic. And he did nothing but bring problems into people's lives wherever he went. The world's a far better place that he's gone. That person has never got over being offended sometime in their life. They've never got over that. Now, I get that. I do get that. I get it. But you can't carry that kind of thing. You can't carry that. This is your dad. I'd like to talk to you. I ain't got no time for you. Click. And look here. Verse 25. Now, his elder son was in the field, and as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf because he hath received him safe and sound. Now the fatted calf was put up for a special occasion. Verse 28, watch. And he was angry and would not go in. Withdraw. Withdraw. See, when people are offended, if you don't deal with your offense, you withdraw. And here's a prime example of it. It's not biblical to do that. It's not biblical to do that, because we're going to talk about that, obviously. But there's withdrawal here. And let me tell you, sometimes in the church, I tell you what, I'm just going to resign ministry. Well, and I mean, sometimes I guess that needs to happen. I mean, I don't know. I mean, scenarios and situations are different. But sometimes people, I'm going to resign the ministry. Or some people quietly quit the church under disguise of something different. Or they still attend, but hey, I'm not going to support the ministry financially. I'm not going to be involved in anything in the ministry. I'll go, but I'm not going to be involved. That's called withdrawal. Now, let's go to 1 Corinthians, turn forward just a little bit, chapter 3. 1 Corinthians, chapter 3. I think that a lesson like this has been a great benefit to me, and it's just always authenticated. When you put these subjects together like this, it just always authenticates the studying and the reading of the Word of God and the Spirit, of course, bears witness with it because it is the Word of God. But let's look here at 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3. Paul says in verse 1, "And I, brethren, cannot speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ." Now, see how Paul's identifying what's going on here? Now, if that wasn't the case, he might address this a little bit different, but he knows where they're at. "I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able." Now, verse 3. "For ye are yet carnal, and whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men?" Now, watch this verse 3. "For ye are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you envying and strife and division." So this is something that was among them. Kind of like a cloud hangs over the house. But what I'm getting at is when something like this hangs over a church or a person, what I'm getting at, they take up an offense. You want to start siding with something you have no business even messing with. Nothing at all. Taking up an offense. "Well, I know there's a problem over here. Maybe I'll get involved in it." You should not be getting involved in it. And that's called taking up an offense. Taking it up. And we shouldn't be taking up stuff like that. If anything, if we know about that, especially in the church, we should be on our knees praying, and we should be 100% absolute neutral. Because if you know it, the leadership knows it. The leadership knows it. And the leadership is doing what they need to do to make sure that that situation is right. Matter of fact, the leadership knows probably 10 times more about it than you know about it. And I'm just saying, don't take up an offense. If there's envying or strife or something like that, hey, what's going on? You can talk to me. "Oh, I can't talk to nobody." Boy, that's the big setup right there. That's the big setup right there. And then the secret meetings. These are all just key things that lead to problems. And I'm going to tell you what, at the end of the day, that kind of stuff will bring judgment upon God's people. It will bring judgment, whether it's physical or mental or financial. It will bring judgment upon God's people. We don't want to do that. So I want to just say this, all of us, let's be careful with the nature when we're offended. Let's be careful making sure. If I'm offended and I think there's something I ought to say, but I'm not bearing witness that it's the Spirit of God, I say nothing at all. Solomon says there's a time to speak and a time to refrain from speaking. Stop, and I'll think through this thing. You know, the other day we were dealing with a little bit of an issue, and an individual called. And the wife said, "They're calling." I said, you're not going to answer it. What am I to do? Nothing. You don't do nothing. What am I going to say? You're not going to say anything. I've not come to the place to give the right answer. You're not saying anything. Well, they can't keep calling. Well, they can keep calling. They can keep calling. But you're not going to give them an answer until I know what the Lord wants. We're not diving into a pool unprepared. So we need to be careful with that carnal nature. And I'm going to say something about the carnal nature. The carnal nature in secrecy loves to belittle other people. Withdrawal. Okay? Taking up an offense. So be careful with that. Now let's talk about responding. We've talked a little bit about this, but let's go a little bit more in another direction with this. Responding to offenses. Well, number one, we need to respond in grace. And I'm going to say this. We sometimes need to be slow with that. We need to be slow with that. I hate to tell us this, but man, we don't have all the answers as quick as you think you have them. You don't have them that fast sometimes, especially if you're coming into a situation that it's one-sided. You are not that equipped, regardless if you're 300 years old and you've been a Christian all your life, or if you're 30 years old and you've been a Christian a week. Obviously, knowledge on the Word of God definitely helps there, but responding to the offense, the offender. I have people that's been offended with me. And they've responded, and I've seen how they've responded, and I've waited sometimes 6 months, maybe sometimes a year. And I picked that thing up. Look, I got notes. Every time there's been an offense in this church, I got a file on it. Every time there's been one. I know who's been told, who's been in it, who hasn't been in it. I know who's what they've said. I keep a file on it. And I keep a file on it, and I keep a file on it just in case 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years down the road, a pastor calls me, I'll pick right back up there. I'll pick right back up at that spot. And I don't mean that in a bad way. It's not what I'm saying. I'm saying to make sure things are done. So I always try to, over a period of time, reach back out and deal with things. And I do. I do. I always have tried to reach back out and deal with situations. Responding to offenses. Well, first of all, let's go to James chapter 5. James chapter number 5. Responding to offenses. Well, we know how we ought not to deal with them, and it's just say, not in the carnal nature. And I know that sounds so easy, but that ain't easy sometimes. That's not easy. So we should never think that operating in the spirit versus operating in the flesh is a simple thing to figure out. We should never do that. Now, why do I say a statement like that? Because you can never in your life trust your flesh or your heart, regardless of who you are, how long you've been saved, how long you've been in church. Your flesh and your heart has got nothing good in it. It never gets better. Our heart and flesh never get better. It never gets better. God is not perfecting our flesh. He's perfecting a divine nature of Christ in us. Paul said that in him, that was in his flesh, dwelt no good thing. And this is probably one of the greatest men that has ever had this earth walk upon it. Okay? Jeremiah said the heart is deceitful. Jesus backed him up. The heart is desperately wicked. No man can know it. You'll never come to that place in your life. But sometimes we try to do that apart from this. And it's just, we can't do that. Not to handle things right. Now, first of all, look at James chapter 5, verse 16. Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that ye may be healed. You know, offenses, what do offenses do? They injure us. Paul told the church at Galatia, you've not injured me. He told the church at Corinth, although I've been grieved in part, I'm good. I'm good. So here we find, confess your faults one to another. Now let me tell you one thing that this does not say. This does not say, confess your sin. You confess your sin to the Lord Jesus Christ. You confess your faults to God first, and then get the right answer, and then go to the individual. The individual, the fault. Well, I shouldn't have done this, or I shouldn't have said that, or I took this for granted. So confession. Confession is the way we respond to offenses. Confession. And I think that's biblical, and I think that's right. Okay, I think that we know works in the Christian relationship. I know that when we're saved, we confess our sin, and we place our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ, we realize we've sinned against God. And we confess that sin and we get saved. But from that point forward, we may mess up in life. And by messing up, we need to try to correct that situation. Now with God, we confess that sin. But with others, confess your faults. Your faults. And, you know, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye that are spiritual, restore him. And so confession. And so if I'm offended, you know, and if I offend somebody, I should confess that. I tell you, some of the hardest things to do in our lives is to say, I'm sorry. Boy, some men and women, some husbands and wives won't even utter that word. They haven't uttered that word their whole marriage. And yet that's why, once again, it's just over and over and over and over and over. You know, I offend my wife sometimes, I'm sure. And she offends me sometimes. And she'll tell me pretty quick, I'm sorry. I mean, pretty quick, I'm sorry. But I've noticed in my own character, I'm a little slow on that. Walk away from the situation, the Lord says, you know what? Yeah, that's how you want to treat this, huh? And I thought, oh man, here we go. I'm not going to be thinking right the rest of the day until I go back in there and take care of the situation and do it right. Whether it's children as well, church members as well, we need to confess our faults one to another. And, you know, and I don't know how deep we need to get into that. Somebody comes to me and confesses a fault, I don't need to get into that deep. I don't, because I think this, it's probably taken a lot for them to just to do that in good character, and I don't need to get too deep into that. Really don't. And I'm going to take the position that Paul says, well, if you to whom you forgive any, I'm with you. I'm going to follow the same rule. Reconciliation. This is how you deal with offenses. Reconciliation. Now, what do we mean by reconciliation? Well, reconciliation has been given to you as a ministry. What, we've been given the ministry of reconciliation. Now, that's kind of a twofold thought there, because we are called to go into the world and preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to other people and try to help them see their need of Christ. And he who winneth souls is wise. And we have been given the ministry of reconciliation. We've been given that ministry. But that ministry not only pertains to that, but that ministry also pertains to you and me. We have a ministry one towards another. This is how we maintain spiritual unity. This is how we maintain spiritual unity. All right, so let's think about this for a moment. Go back to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 5. Matthew chapter number 5, and here we find Jesus Christ preaching what you would call the sermon that he had together, that is, people together on the mount. It's clearly laid out. Matthew chapter 5, verse number 22, we'll start there. But I say unto you, that whomsoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar, and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. Now, as we think about this, no doubt reconciliation is here. I tell you another thing he's saying here, that if we are properly giving to God, properly giving, which I'm told very few percentage of Christians properly give. I don't get into it. It's not my business. I think every Christian ought to biblically give is a good steward, because it all belongs to God, and we ought to show him and we trust him in that. But here's one thing he's telling. If a Christian is properly giving unto the Lord, there's no way they can properly give the way they're supposed to give and have aught with somebody else. It cannot happen. And I believe that principle with all my heart. I'm giving this morning. I already gave. That came in the mail. But I'll be giving tonight. And I'm giving with joy. And when you're offended with somebody, there's no way you're giving with joy. Regardless. And God says we're not to give grudgingly. You getting it? We're not to give grudgingly. God's saying, look, that kind of spirit of coming to me with this needs to be corrected. Well, what's the correction? I don't know. Do you love giving to me like this? Well, that's what you want. Never ask you if it's what I want. Do you love giving to me like this? Well, let me tell you why, how your giving attitude can be better. Because the Lord does love a cheerful giver. Let me tell you how your giving. Remember your brother over here or your sister over here, and this could be family members or church. Remember, yeah, that problem here? Yeah. Why don't you go ahead and take this back home with you? And I don't really want that. I don't really want that. What's more important to me is this over here. And why don't you go take care of this right here? And then once that's taken care of, then why don't you come and bring that to me? And it's almost another thought is God says, I really don't want to accept this with these type of terms in your life. Now, we don't think giving's that important. I think giving is extremely important. It is just as much of my ministry as studying and reading my Bible. No tithing getting messed around with. 10%, whether a preacher's told you different or a Sunday school told you different, they've not told you right. The Bible is clear that tenth of what you have belongs unto the Lord. And we may say that falls underneath Israel. That's a nonsense. It's not true at all. That is not true. When Abraham gave a tenth unto his God, there was not even no such thing as Israel. That ain't gonna work. There was no Israel. There was no nation of Israel. No. He gave a tenth unto the Lord, and we follow his example throughout the whole New Testament, especially in the book of Romans. And then we got missions we need to be supporting. Whether it's a quarter a week or 100 a week, we got missions we need to be supporting. And I'm just telling you that being offended and letting offenses not being dealt with properly can have an effect on your giving. They can have effect on your giving. Now, this doesn't seem like much in a church. You know why? Because God doesn't call your cell phone to remind you about certain things like your bank does. But he will call you one day before him, and he'll ask you to give an account about this. And I don't think that's going to be good. I really don't. Now, I know we're going to be saved from fire. I get all that. But reconciliation. Okay, so what's he really saying here? Before you bring me anything. Okay, now by the way, he does mention here thy gift. So he's not even talking about the tithe. He's not even talking, he's basically talking about a free will offering. And so you see that,
somebody asked me a while back, Pastor, what would you do if somebody left you a couple $1 million? I said, well, I don't want to answer that right quick, but I know one thing. I'd be taking care of a lot of missionaries. I'd be getting on a plane, and I'm serious. I'd be getting on a plane, or I'd have somebody in this church represent me on the mission field to see what's going on. And, buddy, I would put into that. A tenth? Oh, no, I'd do more than a tenth. I probably would keep a tenth and put the 90 out. That's a lot of money, amen. I don't need that kind of money hanging around me. So, reconciliation. We need to reconcile. It's very important. Forgiveness. You know forgiveness is important. Forgiveness. While we're in Matthew, look at chapter 6. And I know these are some principles we know. Look at chapter 6, verse 15. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Verse 14 says, for if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Now, this has kind of got, watch how this is at here. So the psalmist said, if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. That principle right there is applying to this. If we have unforgiveness in our heart, our relationship with God is not good. It's not good. That doesn't mean we're lost and we're not saved. I'm not saying that. But I'm just saying this. We want God. We want to be on a clean slate with God every day in our life. We don't want no marks up there. We want everything as clean as it can possibly be. Forgiveness. Go to Mark chapter 11. Forgiveness. Mark chapter 11. Let's look at verse number 25. So responding to offenses, there is confession, there's reconciliation, and there's forgiveness. Mark chapter number 11, let's please take note at verse 25. And when ye stand praying, forgive. If ye have aught against any, look at that. That your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. But if ye do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. I'm going to say this. I wouldn't want to live knowing that my sins, that God's not forgiven my sins. I have no prayer life. I have no ministry life. I have really nothing. And I'm just saying forgiveness is very, very. Go to Ephesians chapter 4. This is a verse that we're all very familiar with. Ephesians chapter number 4, verse number 32. Verse 30 says, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God." Okay? Now, one way we can grieve the Holy Spirit of God, come down to verse 32, is by not being kind one to another, not being tenderhearted, not forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. So let's put it together. Verse 30, "And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another." And if we don't want to forgive, well, I can just tell you right now, we're going to grieve the Holy Ghost. And that's not what you want to do, because he's your joy, he's your peace, he's your direction, he's the one that's going to produce fruit in your life, he's the one that's going to make you able. And if you harbor stuff in your life, none of that will be a reality. Now, people learn over the years how to deal with this stuff, and they think it's normal. Christians learn to deal with the problems or the effects of sin. They learn how to deal with it and cope with it, thinking that it's just a problem, it's normal with life, when indeed it can go back to something 20 years ago, 15 years ago, or even longer. Love. Love. Well, you know what Jesus said about love. We respond to offenses by love. And this is our last point. John chapter number 13, verse number 34. We're given a new commandment. John chapter 13, verse 34. Well, 24 is good too. What's it say? I'm not sure, but I'm telling you it's good. Because everything in your King James Bible is good. Brother Jerry was out there reading it today, and I said, well, he's got the book open. And I reminded him one time we were in a service, I was in a preaching service, and the pastor gets up and he gives a little introduction. He goes, "Take your Bibles and turn, please." So everybody's getting their Bibles and they're turning, and all of a sudden we kind of feel like where did he say to go to? He didn't. "Please take your Bibles and turn." And he's giving it a time. And then he says, and of course his subject was preaching on the Word of God. Then he says, "It don't matter, just open it up, anywhere in there is good." Yep, and that kind of primed us for the thought that he was about to teach on the Word of God. So here we find in verse 34, "A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another, but watch as I have loved you." And I'm going to be honest with you, as a man, that is a challenge for me, but I work at that. I work at that right there. I work at that with my wife. I work at that with my children. I work at that with the church. And I'm going to tell you another thing. I work with that with this community, because I don't have to go out and knock doors. I don't have to serve this community. But if I love them like Jesus loves them, better believe I'm going to be into that. Better believe I'm going to be. Now watch. This is really in the discipleship, because he's talking to his disciples here. "A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another." Turn over just a chapter or two to chapter 15, verse 12. John chapter 15, verse 12, as we conclude this day's teaching on offenses number 4. "This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you." Now I'm going to say this, and you can agree with me. You know how Jesus loves you. Man, I mean, that's good, isn't it? You know how he loves you. And by the way, John, years later, would work off of the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. I love, of course, all of the Bible beyond the book of Acts, all of it works off of the foundation of the Lord Jesus Christ. The majority of it works off what we find in the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but yet there's no doubt a large portion too falls off of or is found in and built off of the Old Testament. But a lot of teaching is built off of the things that Christ said. And here's one of them. John, writing some 60 years later, 58 years later, here's what he says in 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3, verse 14. "We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death."
Yeah. So love. Love. So we need to be careful how we respond to problems. Boy, and I tell you, we got a world full of them, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we do. We got a world full of problems. And I'm going to tell you something. I mean this. That's why as long as I'm living, you're going to find me. When these doors are open, you're not going to find me every now and then. You're going to find me as much as I'm able to be here. As much as I'm able, I'm right here. I'm right here. And that's just, and there's a reason for that. I'm in the stage of being sanctified and perfected. And I need this because that out there is not going to do that for me. Okay, well, let's have a word of prayer. You've got about, looks like maybe 10 minutes. Get you a drink, restroom, stretch a little bit before church.